Yeah, previously we talked about input normalization, but weight initialization matters too, to have everything on the right or on a good scale. No pun intended here though. So now we are briefly motivating why we care about weight initialization, and then I will show you two common ways to initialize weights, and then we will see how we can do that in PyTorch, or whether we even have to bother about that in PyTorch. So yeah, previously we discussed that we want to initialize weights to small random numbers to break a symmetry in the multilayer perceptron. So I gave it to you as a question to think about, and yeah, we discussed this on Piazza. If you have still questions about that, there was a good answer on Piazza on that. So but besides having small random numbers to break the symmetry, we also want the weights to be relatively small, right? So that is another thing to think about, but it has something to do with what I showed you earlier in an earlier video here about input normalization. So just to explain or motivate this a little bit, think of the multilayer perceptron again, where we here have the multivariable chain rule for updating one particular weight. So this is something I just copy and pasted from a previous slide, nothing new here. But I want you to focus briefly on this part here, where we have the derivative of the activation with respect to the activation in the previous layer. So actually we could expand that to, should have written it like this. Let's do it like this. Z1, 2, and then I'm just expanding it here. So what the critical part here is this part where we compute the derivative of the activation with respect to the input, particularly, for example, if we have something like the logistic sigmoid, right? Because if we have a logistic sigmoid, if you recall, here's the partial derivative of the logistic sigmoid with respect to its input. So the derivative is largest if the input is zero, right? And also, even if it's zero, it's just 0.25. So if we have something like this here, where we have this term, we have a number that is always smaller than one, right? So in this case, this can lead to a so-called vanishing gradient problem, because then we multiply a number with a number smaller than one multiple times if we have many layers. So for instance, if we assume this is the largest gradient or partial derivative we can get for the logistic sigmoid function, and then if we have 10 layers, we have a multiplication with a value that is at most 0.25, and that will degrade the other gradients as well substantially, right? Because if I go back one more time, so we have all these other terms here, right? So the term here, here, and here, it's all multiplied with this one, right? So this is small, then we degrade the whole update here, the gradient here. And this is only for two layers. If we have more layers, we have more of these terms in there if we use the logistic sigmoid. So in fact, then we would, if we have 10 layers, we would degrade the value by about 10 to the power of minus 6. So the gradient will be so small that the network will probably not learn much anymore. So because of that, it's usually a good idea to use other types of activation functions. You can also kind of regulate that with the learning rate, but this is one of the motivations why it's important to initialize the weights centered at zero, for example, if you use a logistic sigmoid function, because then you will have at least the maximum gradient, right? So if I go back, if you have inputs or the net inputs that are small, let's say in this range, or large in this range, then the gradient will be even smaller, right? So in this way, you want to have something that is at least centered at zero. So you can initialize your weights, for example, from a random from a random uniform distribution, for example, in the range 0, 1. But if you use a logistic sigmoid, for example, it might be better to do it in a range between minus 0.5 and 0.5, or maybe even smaller, minus 0.05 and 0.05. So you can also choose a positive range. I mean, if you have a ReLU function, it probably doesn't really matter that much. However, this gives you more combinations if your inputs are also negative and positive, right? So in that way, you can do either or if you have a ReLU. Or you can also, what's very common is to initialize the weights from a random Gaussian distribution with mean zero and a small variance. But these are just some suggestions that have been used in the past. Nowadays, it's actually more common to use either something like the Xavier-Glorot initialization or Kaiming-He initialization. So we will talk about this in the next video.